Okay, great.
Thanks, Fred. So I'm actually, it was announced in the program that it will be Sebastian speaking. It will not be Sebastian, it will be me. So just if you're not familiar with Sebastian, I'm not Sebastian. Okay. So Sebastian and I are actually co-leading the project for 5 or 6 years now. And so actually we've been putting a lot of work in trying to get SAM2 out. And actually, this is one of the moments where I think we're stabilized enough that we can already give you a preview what will be coming out in the coming months. We already distributed some drafts out around the model and the questionnaires toolbox. But so we're really working hard to get the final version out soon. But I'll come back to that. So this talk will be about SAM in general. Just a quick question. Who is familiar with SAM? Maybe I'll turn it around. Who is not familiar with SAM? Okay, half of the audience. So I'll give a bit of an introduction as well to SAM, just to make sure that everybody knows what it is. But the goal of the talk is really to introduce it to SAM2, so the new version that we're really working on. And so I'll spending most of the time of the talk on discussing SAM2 and what is being changed, what have we done, and why have we done it. Really important to understand, and we'll be explaining that. Clearly, we're open for questions and discussions after the talk or afterwards, whenever you want. Oh, so quick words about myself. I've been in the community for more than 20 years. Also in OWASP, more than 10 years. I got involved into SAM around 2008, I think, when back then Praveer was really still working on the project or leading the project. And I got involved as a verifier of the model, trying to get to see whether it. Praveer was really looking for. The feedback on the model, and I was one of the people that gave some feedback to him. I got involved in a project as a co-leader starting 2014-15, I think, because at that point in time we also saw that the project was really used quite a lot in industry, but it was not really moving forward anymore, and we really wanted to kickstart it again to make sure that we can keep on working with it, because we're really convinced that it provides a lot of value to the community, and we should make sure that it continues to provide it like that. So I'm also involved in the Belgium chapter in OWASP, a bit less at the moment because I'm spending most of my cycles on SAM, a bit less on the chapter. I'm employed as well, but let's not go there. I'm still employed at the moment, so let's hope it continues. Okay, so what is SAM? I think the point of SAM is that we're discussing a lot about all the technical challenges that we have to build secure software. So we're trying to see ways how we can improve making Docker, making containerized applications, making sure that we can deploy them on cloud, making sure that we can avoid all this cross-site scripting, SQL injection. We have a lot of technical challenges. Now, one of the big things that we need to address is how we can get organizations to organize themselves to work on all that. And I think, in my opinion, it's one of the core challenges that we're still not very successful in. So how can organizations organize themselves to make sure that they have it under control, that they have some kind of a confidence level in their software, where the software is high risk, that they have it under control, whether it's low risk, okay, then they shouldn't be spending too much time on it, but that they have it under control, whether they built it, whether they acquired the software, what have you. And that's actually what SAM is trying to aim at. So we're really trying to give you a maturity model, and I'll come back to that, to analyze where you are as an organization, what am I doing, to also reason about what I should be doing, where do I want to go with this, and so what are the steps that I need to take as an organization to get more control on the security of your software, basically. That's what SAM is all about. So it's not a technical project. It's really about organization-wide measures and how can you fit everything together. Okay, what else is important? So it's for development and acquisition. I think that's really important. Very often people think of SAM or SDLC in terms of you're building software, you're developing, typing software. But it's not limited to that. If you're a company, if you're a small company or large company and you're acquiring software rather than building it, this also applies. There will be a number of activities that are less relevant, but it still will apply to those companies. So that's really important, I think. We built the model to be technology and process agnostic. Also really important, because sometimes the model is considered as a secure waterfall model. It's totally not a secure waterfall model. And I can understand why people think that, but it's definitely not meant to be a secure waterfall model. This is a maturity model. It's not a process model. So you're not getting a process out of it. You're getting a set of activities that you should be thinking about. How you fit them into a process, that's up to you. We don't define that. It's up to you as an organization to define that. But it's also process and technology agnostic. So whether you waterfall or agile or DevOps or what have you in the next few years, this model will apply. And we built it as such that it will apply like that. And we're trying to give you guidance on how to do it. And I'll come back to that as well in the talk. But also it's agnostic on the method, but also on the technology. Whether you deploy in the cloud, whether you're using containers, whether you're doing APIs, yes or no, this model will still apply. And again, we will try to help you to make the model apply to your specific context. But the model in itself is agnostic of that. It's a risk-driven model, and it's meant to be evolutive, so it will change continuously. And then we like to consider it or conceive it as well as an umbrella project, because actually when you think of it, and I might be hitting some legs here and there of project leaders in the room, so I'm happy to do that, and please come hit me afterwards. But we like to think of it as an umbrella project, because actually all the activities that are happening within OWASP, somewhere they fit into this model. So we've done the test. A couple of years ago, we've tried to set all the links and see, okay, all the OWASP projects, where do they fit? We could all of them, we could fit under this model somewhere. So for us, it's kind of an umbrella framework for all the things that OWASP is doing. We haven't convinced all the other leaders yet, but it's a mission. It's our mission. Okay, so let's talk about this maturity model. Why would you want to use a maturity model? So there are a lot of process models out there. So like Microsoft or Touchpoints, or you have a lot of these models that give you the process as an organization to put a process in place. This is not a process model, it's a maturity model. So what it does, it tries to give you elements to measure where you are and to go forward. Now, it's really important that we want to do this in an iterative way. So you can measure where you are today, you can reason about where you want to be in 3 months, in 6 months, in 1 year. So it's not a fixed point in time solution that will apply every time. It's continuous improvement. In order to do that, you need a model to support that. So it's iterative. That's a first property of a maturity model. A second property is that it's risk-based. We put in place a number of activities and a number of ways in which you can reason about risk in an organization and what should I be doing with that risk. Should I be doing a code review on a low-risk application? Probably not, because it's going to cost you way too much to do a code review on low-risk application. On what application should I be doing a code review? That reasoning is actually included as a core element into the model. The model tries also to give you details about what you should be doing in activities. Details, take that with a grain of salt. It's not like an entire standard one-page document on every activity, but it's trying to explain you, okay, why should be doing that and what can you do to make it happen in an organization? And so that's really what SAM is about. And these are maturity models, and that is what SAM is about. So it gives you a measurable way to perform actions or activities in organization, and it's flexible. You can go anywhere with it depending on your specific application organizational context. Okay? Clear? Right. There has been quite a lot of confusion on where you can find it as a starting point. The current website is owaspsam.org and not opensam.org. A lot of people still go to the old website. This is where you find the recent information. So currently, we have two versions online. Version 1.5, which is still the stable version. 1.5 is actually a slow graduation of the original version 1.0. So it's backwards compatible. The measuring model is the same. We changed some terminology here and there to make it a bit more in line with recent activities, but it's still backward compatible. That's a stable model still. And then version 2, which is the model that we're currently working on, that model is in beta. So we're really working hard to get it to final state. At this point in time, I would say that it's getting stable enough so that you can do first tests in organization to actually do the measurements and the improvement steps with that model already. I think we are there. But clearly, if you're in an organization only want to work with a stable model, then it's a bit too soon. We'll be there in the coming months. Okay, so two versions and a website important. The structure of the model is the following, and that's the structure of the version 1.5 model. For those that are not familiar with the model, this is the structure of the current stable model. So it consists of four business functions, and these business functions are so governance, construction, verification, operations. These are actually functions that should relate quite well with what people are doing in an organization. So every organization has an operations team, typically. They would have a development team, so construction, development. They would have a quality assurance team, right? And they would have people to take care of policies, governance, education. So these business functions try to relate to how your organization is typically structured, right? Under these business functions, we have security, what we call security practices, and there are three security practices per business function. So if you would look at, for instance, governance, there is a security practice on strategy and metrics, one on education and guidance, and one on policy and compliance, right? This is actually the core structure. Underneath that, you will find all the elements to do the measurement. Underneath these security practices. Let me give you one example. Let me give you one example in that sense. In education and guidance, there will be, for every maturity level, and in the model there are three maturity levels, 1, 2, and 3. Level 0 is basically you're doing nothing. Level 1 is you're doing something in an ad hoc way. Level 2 is you're doing it in a more effective way in the organization. Level 3 is you're doing it in a really mastery way with continuous improvements in the organization. In every level, you will have activities underneath these security practices. And so for education and guidance, there would be for level 1, in the top row, there would be two activities for level 2 again and level 3 again. Now what I'm showing here is actually the way you can measure how mature you are. So this is already the assessment or the measurement. So what you would see here is for education and guidance at level 1, there are two questions that you need to answer. There's actually a question per activity, right? So the question, have developers been given high-level security awareness training, is actually measuring whether you're doing general security awareness training in the organization, right? So you can answer, you can give it different answers. So no, we're not doing it. Yeah, we have done it once, like 3 or 4 years ago, but we haven't repeated it. We're doing it every 2 to 3 years, and we're doing it every year. Depending on how often you do it, you would get a score. Right? And the score is actually noted on top. It's actually underneath in the model, the scoring itself, the details are not so important to understand, but okay, it's visible. So you would get a score based on your answer. And so for all the activities in the security practices, according to these levels, you would do all these questions and you would get the scoring out of that. Okay. Is that clear? Because it's actually the core of the model. Is that clear to everybody? Yeah? Okay. Perfect. Okay, so if you are doing that as an assessment, so what would come out is on the left-hand side, you would get these kind of graphics coming out. So we have them in different representations. There's spider diagrams. You have these kind of bar charts. We have them in different representations, but basically it's always the same. Per security practice, you would get what maturity level am I at that security practice. That's basically the idea. That's the first element. Second element is you can then start thinking about where do I want to go? What would be the 2B? And then you can create these kind of roadmaps or charts that state, okay, in the current phase, I'm at the left-hand side, and in 4 phases, I want to go to the 2B phase, and that's kind of how it's evolving, right? There's a lot of logic behind there, a lot of reasoning. These graphs are actually really interesting to distribute in the organization because it gives them a kind of an interesting, a quick view on, okay, what are we doing in terms of software security in the organization? So these things are all generated out of toolboxes that we provide you. It's all open, available, free. It's an OWASP project, so it's all available. So, and the toolboxes generate that automatically for you if you do the maturity assessment. There are different ways in which you can do maturity assessments. You can do it in self-assessment, so one person doing the assessment, just running through all the questions. We typically would do it in interview style, interviewing different people in the organization. One thing that's really important in doing assessments is the scoping part, because quite often you in organizations you would have different business units or teams or projects that operate in a different way. One team does technology X, the other team does technology Y, one team does Agile, the other team does Waterfall. So it would, in that case, it would be impossible to do a single assessment for the organization. So what you would typically do is you would scope parts of the organization, you would do different assessments and then bring all the data together to have a view on the organization. So that about scoping. Okay. So that was kind of a high level overview of SAM 1.5. I hope that was clear because now we're going to the SAM 2.0 part. Okay. So why did we want to do a new version? First of all, a first reason is the previous version was too old. I think that's already a good reason in itself. The original version dated back from 2009. Yeah, 10 years in IT time, it's like eternity. So we couldn't afford to not evolve. We have done iterations of the previous model. So we had version 1.1, 1.5. There's a lot of logic behind there. Why we're skipping the other versions, but okay, let's not go there. But so they were still very much similar to the original model, right? Okay. Now what we saw in the model is that we had a lot of discussions, for instance, with agile development. Yeah, but you're giving us a waterfall model. We're doing agile development, and while it's not conceived to do only waterfall, I can understand those reasoning, because if you were going to look at the activities and the phrasing that was used in the model, it was kind of aligned towards waterfall, because 10 years ago, Agile was not that widespread as it now is. If you would try to translate the original model into DevOps, yeah, good luck. It was not so easy to do. So that's the first reason. We had to align it to more recent development practices. That's the first reason. A second reason, if you look at the model closer, you would see sometimes activities that seem like orphans, in the sense that at some point in time at level 2, there would be an activity and that's all isolated. There is no other activities or things going on in the model that would relate to that activity. We call them orphaned activities. They were there for a good reason 10 years ago. Right now, we don't think the reason is that good anymore. So we want to get rid of those like isolated activities in the model. That's the second reason. The third reason, I already discussed, the model agnostic. Yeah, you want to be agnostic of whether it's waterfall or agile. We really wanted to improve that, because otherwise the model would be dead, because most of organizations are shifting towards agile DevOps development anyway. The fourth reason is we wanted to improve assessments, and I'll explain that in more detail, but the current assessments in version 1.5 is looking only at coverage. To what extent are you doing it? It's not looking at quality. How well are you doing it? So you might be doing a lot of things. You might be writing coding guidelines, stuck them in a closet, and nobody looks at them. You would tick the box, but actually in practice, it would not work at all. We wanted to improve that, really, to make sure that what we're measuring actually is helping the organization to improve the practices. That was really important, and we spent a lot of time discussing on that. And final reason for us is we want to improve the production process. In order to generate version 1.5, you can't imagine the pain that we had to try to bring out the book, because we had to do actually PDF editing in the book itself to actually edit it, for lots of reasons, historical reasons and others, but it was very painful to produce new versions. We really wanted to get rid of that, because it was costing us a lot of cycles. So we wanted to really improve the production process. How can we generate the books, the websites, the assessment sheets, all that? And we've worked a lot on that as well. So that were for us the most important reasons to move forward. So we started working on that about 2 or 3 years ago. We've had a lot of discussions. A lot of discussions that also led us to the fact or to the objective that we didn't want to be backwards compatible. If we could be, that would be fine. But it was not the goal. We wanted to redefine the model and see where do we get. If it's compatible, that's fine. If it's not compatible, that's fine as well. And it turns out that we're not compatible at all. So it will really be a breaking point for organizations to move from version 1x to version 2. And we will try to give you migration support to go from one to the other, but it's really a breaking point. Okay, looking at the business functions for SAM.2, what you will see is actually we kept the governance function, the verification function, and the operations function, but the construction function, which was there before, was actually split in two. into design and implementation. And actually the design function was kind of there in version 1.x. The implementation function was not at all there. And everything related around secure build, secure deployment, CI/CD, all these elements were not covered in the previous model. They're nowadays so important that we cannot do without them. So actually what kind of is new is we defined the implementation function as a totally new business function to be added into the model. Okay. If we then look at the security practices underneath that these business functions, again, you will see that in general, if you would look at governance, it would be the same for version 1.5 from a high-level perspective. It would be the same as version 1.5. The security practices by name are the same. Underneath, the activities are not, but by name, they are the same. If you would look at operations, it very much resembles what was there in version 1.5. If you look at implementation, it's totally new. Totally new activities. We also actually restructured the way we do testing, so verification. We totally restructured that. The goal was the same. So you still want to do DASTs, automated scanning, SAST, code review scanning. You still want to do that. But the way we structured it is actually quite different in the new version. All right. One thing we introduced in version 2 is the concept of streams. And why did we do that? Actually, to get rid of those orphaned activities I was explaining about. So these isolated activities that you cannot relate to anything else. So what we did is for every security practice, we actually defined two streams. And this is security practice, I'm not sure it's security testing. And actually the streams here is in security testing, you want to do something about verifying whether the controls that you want, they have to put in place in the software are there. That's control verification. And the second one is, okay, can I actually abuse the software in some way? So it's a totally different thing that you're trying to achieve. And we've identified two streams. So every stream actually now has activities over the maturity levels. So for control verification, there are three activities for every level. For misabuse testing, it's the same. By doing this, we really forced ourselves to work in this way to make sure that we always had a clear, improvement of maturity throughout the model. And by doing that, we didn't have the orphaned activities anymore. Right. And we always took the same type of reasoning for all the security practices that we defined. So looking at the model right now, you would still have a security practice. You would still have three maturity levels. You would have two streams per maturity level and the activities that go underneath the two security streams. Right? Okay. Okay, then this is actually what the current model looks like to the level of streams. So not yet activities, but to the level of streams. I don't know whether it's still readable in the back. I had to put a lot on one slide. Is it doable or... Yeah, okay. So you will see the five business functions, governance, design, implementation, verification, operations. You will see the security practices at the left in gray. And then you will typically see the streams. So there's one stream and second stream. There's no logical ordering between the stream. So the stream in the left is independent of the stream in the right. It's not that you have to do the left one first before the right one or vice versa. They're independent. Okay, so that's one element. So if you look, for instance, at education and guidance, you would see two streams, training and awareness. That was actually already there. You want to provide general awareness training, role-specific training. That was actually in model 1.5 as well. But now we have a new one in yellow, which is organization and culture. We realized that we wanted to do something really to make sure that the organization very well understands and organizes itself around security or secure software. This is what we called organization and culture. There are a number of activities beneath that. I'm not going to go into details, but that's what the two streams are. If you look now at this model, actually all the yellow ones are new. And that's what I mean with not backward compatible. This is what it looks like. And half of the streams are actually new or have been significantly changed compared to the previous model. Okay. Let me take another one. secure deployment at the middle of the slide. We're looking at the deployment process itself. Is it defined? Is it automated? Do you do automated security testing as part of the process? These kind of elements. And we're looking at secrets management, because if you want to deploy a piece of software, you will have to protect the secrets that are necessary to get access to a database, to another component in the software. So that's secret management. That second part, for instance, it was not existing. The deployment part either. It was not existing in the previous model. Okay? So it gives you an overview of, okay, how different are we compared to the previous version. Okay, moving on to scoring. Scoring in version 1.5, and I've shown you the previous scoring tab where you could actually score different activities by means of the questions. What would happen in version 1.5 is you would get a question like, okay, is there a software security assurance program in place? And you would get four possible answers. Answers would be, no, there is not. Or yes, it's less than a year old. Or yes, it's regularly, it's a pretty mature program. These type of answers. Okay. Again, as I stated before, we were measuring, is it there? And is it somewhere in the organization? But not, is it a good program? So what about, is the program, does it make any sense? Is it a one pager? Yes or no? Or does it really have useful information on what the program is? How fresh is the program? Has it been updated? How is it, has it been reviewed, updated? Who has validated it? All these elements. Is the program still relevant? All these questions you can ask yourself, and we couldn't really answer that in the previous model. So what we were doing was more like an audit style type of assessment. You would say, okay, I'm passing the checkbox. And how good it is, yeah, we're not really measuring that in any way. We really wanted to get rid of that way of measure. Or we want to improve it. Not get rid of it, but improve it. Okay, so we have been discussing quite extensively how we're going to do that. And we basically decided, okay, we want to measure two dimensions. One dimension is coverage, and one dimension is quality. Coverage, it's still linked to what you've known before. So is it there? Is it applied to one application, to the majority of applications? That's coverage. You're measuring how often you are doing these things. Quality is you're measuring how good you're doing these things. Now, it's important to understand that measuring these elements is not necessarily the same thing. The weight that you can apply to measuring coverage versus quality might differ. It might be more difficult to increase the quality than increase the coverage. If you're doing automated pen testing for half of the applications, yeah, going to almost a full set is probably quite easy. Improving the quality of automated pen testing is probably more difficult. So how you measure that, it's not necessarily the same. So then we got into a lot of discussions, and actually very interesting discussions, but sometimes also very late night discussions. But how do we want to measure that? And do we want to really measure quality next to coverage in the same way? That means by a lot of security questions that you need to fill in and approve, and then we have lots of data that we can try to combine in some using some measurements or weights to get out to get a meaningful number out. So in the end, we decided to make it as simple as possible, because we figured if we're going to make it too complex, people are not going to use it. One of the ideas that we had is, okay, let's make coverage measurements mandatory and quality measurement optional to get it not too complex for people to get into it. We also dropped that idea. We want to measure both. I think it's really important. So what we decided to do in version 2 is actually, for measuring coverage, we're still going to do the questions like we had before. For measuring quality, what we have defined is quality criteria. So we're actually specifying what do we think should be there if you're answering yes to coverage. If you're saying we're doing static analysis for half of the applications, then we think that you should have a good tool in place, that the rule set should be adapted to the organization, that the rule set has been verified. These are, for us, mandatory quality elements that should be in place before you can say you're doing it. Okay, so questions, quality criteria, and the quality criteria are mandatory. Currently, we have defined in this entire set. It will turn out whether this set will work for the community, yes or no. It might be the case that sometimes we're too strict. That is nearly impossible to get there. Sometimes we're too flexible. That is too easy to get there. We'll have to do a bit of fine-tuning there. But what you will see is this is the current toolbooks, so the current measurement model, what you will see is in the create and promote stream, which is one stream under strategy and metrics, there are three questions. Every question you can answer with an answer. Again, four options. No, partially, half, typically these kind of answers. And then the security, the quality criteria are under the question. And these are like indicators. This is what we expect you to be doing to answer that question. So these are the mandatory elements that need to be in place in order to do that activity. Does that make sense? Yeah? Okay. And actually, if you think of it, it actually resembles quite well one of the very early spreadsheets that we had before. But there, the guidance was more like to 8 people, okay, what you should be thinking about. We had a lot of discussions, a lot of options. In the end, we kind of decided to go back to that model because it was quite elegant. The only difference is that this is mandatory. The quality is mandatory to do the measurement. Before it was not really the case. Right? Okay, so this is a picture of the new toolbox. It has been distributed last week. It's out on GitHub. You can use it. You can start playing with it. And actually, we're currently really soliciting feedback on that because it's our view of the world, which is definitely a limited view. So we're really interested in hearing your feedback about it. So if you can apply it in your organization, please do it and get back to us about what you think about the model. I do think that currently, I mentioned before, the model is already quite stable. I don't think that the structure of the model will change very much anymore. What might be still changing a bit here and there is the questions and the quality criteria. Because, it's a first good draft, but we definitely can improve. Okay, moving on. In the project, I told you before, we have had a very inefficient way of working and producing documents. We totally changed the way we work in the project. So currently, all the content is on GitHub, and it's a single source of the truth. So it's all open, it's all there for you, and you can work with it. And we are generating everything based from that. So all the questions, all the activity descriptions, all the what have you, all that information is driven from GitHub. And we have tools to automatically generate all the rest. The website that you saw before is automatically generated. The toolbox, actually, we managed to automatically generate it from GitHub as well, which is actually very, very neat because we first did a manual construction of the new toolbox. It took us like 1 or 2 days. If you now have to update it every time, it will take us a lot of effort. So now we have a way to automatically generate the toolbox if we change the questions and the quality criteria. Yeah. Okay. And actually that's been done by producing JSON that can be actually questioned interacted with. We are also planning on opening up those elements to the community. So if you're building a tool that actually wants to be in line with the latest version of the model, we'll open that up. It's all on GitHub, and we'll open up like APIs or interfaces to be able to query the model and to work with it. So, and we're hoping for a lot of interested people to do that. Okay, about the community. So we're actually an OWASP project. We have a core team that's actually working hard, but this model only will work if the community supports it very well. And we're actually hoping for a lot of community support and involvement. Now, if you would look at how we're currently structured in terms of producing the model, at the top you would see the core structure, which is like the business functions and the security practices. And then, based on that, we're actually defining the evaluation model. And we actually turned around how we worked. Because beforehand, we were defining all the activities and what they mean, how they are described. Currently, how we're working is we're first defining how we're going to evaluate. And then we're going to define what an activity actually means. And there's actually a good reason for that. It's a maturity model. It's meant to measure. Measuring is really important in that sense. So our reasoning was we first have to define how we're going to measure and then the explanation of what we're trying to measure can follow later. Okay, so that's the evaluation model, activity model. And then there's a lot of supporting information. One that is particularly interesting, I think, is the guidance. So what we have set up is that for all the activities, we open up feedback from the community and seeing what you can do with that. And let me give a good example. Rob in the room actually is going to give a talk after this one on agile security, on agile, good doing agile with Sam, has provided an entire guidance section on how you can apply Sam in an agile context. What that means is for every activity he has described, or for the most important ones in for agile, he has described how would you do that in an agile context. As I said before, the model tends to be, or we want it to be method agnostic. We don't want to create a model, an agile model, but this is how we can link it to particular contexts, whether it be agile, DevOps, whether it be cloud or other, what have you. This is where it's really open to the community, where you can actually contribute and explain how you could use that model in a particular context. Okay, so the top three elements are actually driven by the project core team. The bottom element is actually driven by community, linking to a specific OWASP project or external references, providing this guidance. It's opened up, and we will really want to open it up to the community for you to contribute. It will be done via GitHub as well, and we really want it to be an open model. And clearly, we're really looking for feedback from the community as well. If you have the chance to apply it in your organization, let us know how it works, because we really want to improve it to make sure that it works for you. Not for us, but for you. Okay. One very challenging topic was the benchmark, the data. So a typical question that you would see in an organization, okay, how do I compare to my peers, right? That's the first question that you would typically get. And unfortunately, at this point in time, we don't have the perfect answer yet, but we're really working on it. So we have been defining the benchmark project, and actually Brian Glass is one of the persons leading that project, where we really want to try to get as much as possible data from organizations in, and that data will be anonymized. So as an organization, you don't have to worry that we disclose information about the organization. That's not the point. But the point is that you can at least as an organization see what other organizations are doing. So we're setting up a model in which you can anonymously submit data to us, and we'll combine it and make it again available to the community. There were quite some challenges that we had to tackle, and I'm not going to spend too much time there, but actually we're trying to work on that. The idea was to have it up and running by the release of version 2 final. I'm not sure whether we'll get there, but we're doing our utter best to get you the data, because we fully realize that this is half of the project. If we have this, it will work way better for you guys in the organizations. Okay, where are we on time? Okay, a few minutes should be fine. The current roadmap, as I told you before, we plan to release the final version by the end of 2019. Please don't shoot it if we don't, because we have already been postponing a few times. But we're really doing our utter best to get it out, because we think it's really important to not spend too much time. In 2020, our plans are to release more frequently. So with all the automation in place, we can actually do small increments of the model and push out a new version much more faster than we did before. So versions 2.1.2.2, we can push them out very much, much faster. We definitely want to work on the Agile and DevOps guidance. Agile is there already quite a bit. So thanks to Rob, very, very nice contribution there. DevOps, we are currently nowhere. So we have no, so if there's anybody interested in supporting the project and writing how you could apply this in DevOps, please come and talk to us. And we also plan on giving more roadshows and trainings to actually explain how we can work with things. Looking forward, what else? In order to get more data in, one of the things that we have in mind is to put online an online assessment tool, open for everybody to use, but via that means we can collect data. It will make it easier for you and for us. We're trying really our best to get all the data in to make sure that you have the data, basically. It will be a totally open data set. Eh? That's the promise that we make. Support for regulations. Okay, that's, I think. Important message. There's quite some value in this model. Give it a try. You'll really start appreciating more and more the model once you give it a try. It's really the proof of the eating is in the proof of the pudding is in the eating. We can try. Both leaders are from Belgium. We'll try to give some next time. Okay. Okay. Then, So a few words of thanks. So this is the current core project team. You can see it's already quite an extensive set of people. We have sponsors. We're looking for more sponsors. We're doing very good efficient things with this with this money. For one, we typically organize twice a year a summit for the project team, because we know that when we're a few days together, the advancement, the progress that we make is way more than what we do in half a year time via remote calls and whatever. So we try to organize twice a year these summits, but we're not wasting the money. So please, if you have spare money, come and talk to us. Actually, that's also Seba is the person to talk to if you wanna if you're interested in sponsoring. So final notes on reachability. The website is there. We are on Slack. We have different channels on Slack. The main Slack channel is that one. It's under the OWASP channel. There's a newsletter coming out approximately every month. If you want to subscribe to the newsletter, use that QR code, and there's mailing list, and all our material is on GitHub. If you want to look around, feel free. It's all available. And that's about it. And just in time for maybe a few questions. Okay. Yep.
First of all, congratulations. This is really useful work. One challenge that I have, I'm working with Fred.
So we're working in a large organization, and it's good to have the point in time validation and the scores, but we're also looking for a way to do this as a regular exercise, to have a cyclic assessment every 6 months or something like that. And for that, we're also looking for tools to support the teams to do kind of a self-reporting, because if you need to engage an auditor to do it for a large scale, it just doesn't work. Yeah. I don't know if there are any plans for that kind of tooling.
Well, there's actually had discussions with people that are doing that in their organizations. Currently, from the project, the tool, we don't have it readily available, but people have been doing it. So I know for a fact that Jan Kravchenko, who is one of the core members, has been setting that up. He's in the organization, has been developing his own tooling to do that. So I would say, reach out to Jan, ask where he is, and he has been doing that. I've also been talking to Dennis Cruz, who also has been setting that up, but he had a really interesting way of doing this. Rather than creating a specific tool for it, he just created it like activities in their typical Trello or whatever activity task manager that you're using, and so he's distributing all the work via the regular task management system that you were using in the organization. And by doing that, he was getting all the feedback back. He could track very well where are we in that, and that's how they did it in their company. I've seen different ways from the project out. Currently, we don't have the perfect solution or the tool to do that. It's definitely something that we think is important, and I've seen several people do it. So I would suggest talk to those people, see how they do it. Maybe they can share their tools. Okay. Yeah.
So first of all, I'm very grateful for this tool. We are using this tool, this model in the project level, and it is really giving us a very clear guidance how to use it. However, there are two requirements we have. We just thought it'll be useful. One is the assurance report. Mainly the digital transformation project, when the other enterprises want to join the platform, they ask, hey, can you show me some evidence-based report saying this has been done and your platform is secure so that we can integrate with your platform and with our system? So by any chance, can we generate some report which is giving them the assurance along with your maturity graphs? We can say, right, this is the control here and it has been properly tested by this way. So this gives them more evidence-based assurance. Second thing is on the product owners. They ask for the return of investment. Okay, we have spent this much money on the control implementation. From your monitoring, can you show this control, this many attacks has been stopped on the live environment so that the investment, what we made implementation for this security program is justifiable? So these are the two questions I have.
The first question, the compliance report, I think it's, should I repeat the question or was it clear to everybody? Yeah. Okay, time's up. I can't answer. No, I'll quickly answer. And then any other questions we can take offline. Is that fine? So the first question, I think compliance reports, there's two answers to that. First of all, it will depend on the way you assess. Because we distinguish between lightweight and in-depth assessments. Lightweight means you can do a self-assessment based on some interviews and you just say yes or no or half. The in-depth assessment is more like, an assessment where you're actually verifying proof of what their statement is. Right? They're saying, I'm doing this for half my applications I'm doing SEST. Okay, show me all the results, show me the report. That's the in-depth way of testing. Currently, in the model, there is no way of capturing the results of that in-depth check. In the model, we can build it. It's currently not existing. So that's one part of the answer. The second part of that answer is, for the current data that we have, like the lightweight, we can easily generate a report. I think it's a matter of creating a tool and, that can generate based on a template some kind of report. And I'll take it along as one of the GitHub issues that we should think about. Can we create something like that? Currently, it doesn't exist. It shouldn't be too hard. We have all the data. So it's a matter of spending some cycles. That's the first question. And then the second question was around, sorry, can you Okay, yeah. Actually, it's the $1 million question. And, we can, to some extent answer it in this project. And I'll show you how. If you look at strategy and metrics, we've put in much more focus on monitoring, measurement and monitoring. Right? If you see upper down strategy and metrics, the top row. Measure and improve. And also in the defect management, metrics and feedback learning. We've put a lot more focus in the model on these metrics. That means that we are convinced that you should continuously measure what you're doing. And we've put several activities in place to do that. Using these metrics, you should be able to partially answer that question. Now, whether then it's really return on investment financially, that's a different story. And there, I'm afraid at this point, if somebody has that answer, please, the entire community would like to know how we do that because it's basically an open question. It's really difficult to solve. Okay? Thank you.